And as you can notice, there are intersections, and there's two specific things I want you to notice. One of them is called a spur. So a spur is a vertex such that it's incident to two edges that overlaps each other. So here is B is a spur. And the other one is a fork. A fork is a vertex such that it's contained inside the interior of another edge. So here I is a fork. So spurs make so spurs will be really important later on. Now I can define something, have an intuition of a kind of polygon that we call a weakly simple polygon. So intuitively, a weak simple polygon is a polygon that it touches itself, can overlap, but it does not cross itself. So for example, this one, A, B, C, D, G, F, then go back again, D, C, A. So there is an overlap of the edge C, D, but there's no crossing. So this is quite natural. For example, in the self-touching integers, you will get polygons like this. And sometimes when there's polygons with holes, you can add edges to make it into a weakly simple polygon. Weakly simple polygons, any algorithm that works for simple polygons could also work for weakly simple polygons without any change. So of course it's natural to ask what's not a weakly simple polygon. So if there's any crossing, then the polygon is not weakly simple. So this is trivially not weakly simple because it's crossing between two edges. We can define a crossing because sometimes the edges coincide. So we can define a crossing as if we start, so if there's two paths that goes converges to one point, then goes together for a while, then leaves to different, to opposite directions, and then we can call this a crossing. So this is a forward crossing when the path goes the same way, and then there's a backward crossing where the path is going a different direction. This will be an example where, so there are two polygons here. One is A, B, C, D, E, F, D, C, A, which is really simple. And the other one, the only thing changes if C connects to F and D connects to A. So it's A, B, C, D, F, D, C, A. So this one. But this one has a crossing. But notice on the image of the polygon is the same on the plane. It's the same. I'm just drawing it such that you can see the difference. So there's another way that a polygon may not be a weakly simple polygon. So consider the polygon AX, BX, CX. This is weakly simple. But the polygon AX, BX, CX, AX, BX, CX, which rotates around this. This image twice, it's not really simple. So these two intuitions give us a way so there are ways to try to capture this intuition. For example, Tosson gave a definition saying polygons weakly simple if its rotation number is plus negative 1. And it cannot be partitioned into two crossing subpaths. The rotation number is the sum of exterior angles, sum exterior angles, where the angles normalize to negative pi and pi. So this is a polygon's rotation number plus negative 1. However, if there's a spur, so these two points coincide. However, if there's a spur, we cannot define rotation number. Also, even if there is a rotation number, for example, this polygon has rotation number 1, it still might not be the case that it can be partitioned into two to crossing subtypes. For example, in this polygon, there are two crossings. However, there's no way to partition this polygon into two polygonal curves such that they cross. And there's other various definitions trying to capture this idea, but most of them either are too restrictive or they are false positives. So here we will define weakly simple. So a closed curve is weakly simple if I can make arbitrary small perturbations to make it simple. So more formally, what I'm saying is a curve is weakly simple if it's a limit of simple curves under the Fréchet distance. For polygons, we can define another kind of weakly simple, which we call rigid weakly simple. So polygon is rigidly weak simple if an arbitrary small perturbation of the vertices can make it simple. For example, I am perturbing the vertex x to make this polygon rigidly weak simple. So there's a theorem showing those two definitions are essentially the same for polygons. So if P is a polygon with at least three vertices, then P is weakly simple if and only if P is rigidly weakly simple. And this requires non-trivial result on people more. So this is intuitive, but it's not easy to prove. So we have an algorithm that decides if an n-gon is weakly simple in n squared log n time. And if the n-gon has no spurs or forks, or no forks, then we can go faster in n log n time. So a polygon, so the image of the polygon on the plane, so planar straight line graphs, and the nodes are the vertices of the polygons, and the segments are the subdivided edges of the polygon. And we just remove the duplicate vertices. For example, the polygon, so for both of these two polygons, AX, BX, CX, and AX, BX, CX, got around twice, it has the same image graph. And it has nodes A, B, C, X, and segments AX, BX, CX. I use nodes and segments to differentiate between the edges and vertices in the polygon. So if let's assume there's no forks in the polygon, and with this assumption, we present the following algorithm. So if we first construct the image graph, then we repeatedly apply this operation called expansion. And we either detect a local crossing at some point, then we know it's not weakly simple, or the image graph gets reduced to a cycle or a trivial graph. So when the image graph is a cycle or a trivial graph, you know how to check if the polygon is weakly simple or not. So this algorithm is essentially the same as Cortes et al.'s algorithm. So that algorithm is considering a closed work on our plane graph and check if it's weakly simple, but in our graph drawing terminology. So we have to define what we mean by expansion. So we consider this, so we have a polygon Q, and we also have its image graph Q. So we can expand around some disk D, so it just has to be a topological. The way we expand it is we first draw the topological disk, and for every path that enters this disk and then leaves this disk, we straighten the path. And we do this on the polygon. For example, see this blue path enters this region and leaves this region, and we just straighten as one straight edge. And similarly for the green path, and even for a spur. So this purple point is spur. we're deleting all the nodes inside, and then we add new nodes around the boundary of this disk. Then we add a few more edges to connect. One important thing about this is, if the original polygon is weakly simple, then after we apply this general expansion, then the new polygon is also weakly simple. But the converse is not true. So during the expansion, it's possible that we can detect some local crossings. For example, if in a polygon there's this blue path and then this red path, after the expansion we get a crossing edge. And this is really easy to detect. So for us, we have two specific examples of the general expansion. One of them is a node expansion. So node expansion is, we are doing expansion around a disk, around a single node. What's nice about node expansion is that if the original polygon is weakly simple, then the one after node expansion is also weakly simple, and if the one after is weakly simple, so is the original one. So this is the if and only if condition. And this is true even if the polygon has spurs. So if the polygon does not have spurs, our algorithm does first do node expansion on every node. And then we try to construct a two regular plane graph as a fold. So for every segment, we also know the multiplicity of the segment, basically how many times an edge traverses this segment. And for the segment outside the node expansions, we just duplicate it by creating parallel segments. And for the ones inside the node, inside the disk in the node expansion, there's a unique way to connect them without causing any intersections, crossings. And once we do this, then we can check if this two regular plane graph is connected and actually matches the polygon. If it does, then it's weakly simple. However, if we have spurs, it's no longer the case that we get a unique two-regular plane graph. So consider there's two spurs, and there are actually four ways to arrange this two spurs. And the fact is, the number of ways is exponential with the number of spurs. Therefore, the node expansion itself is not enough. So we use a segment expansion. The segment expansion is I take a disk around the segment and then expand it, just as the ending is the general expansion. However, there's still a problem with spurs. When we do a segment expansion carelessly, it's possible that we expand it's possible that there's a non-weakly simple polygon and we expand around some segment and get a simple polygon. So this is one of the examples. Therefore, we have to restrict on the kind of segment we expand. To do this, we've introduced what a base segment is. So for our segment, let's say the segment AB, the segment AB is a base for the node A. If every vertex in A is connected to an edge in segment A, so for every vertex in A, it's connected to something in segment A. And this is, so segment AB is the base of A. And then we can call our segment to be safe if it's the base of both of its endpoints. expansion of a safe segment always preserve weakly simplicity. So we always get the if and only if condition. However, sometimes just expanding safe segment is not enough, because in this example, expand the safe segment, but nothing changed in the entire in the polygon. The only thing changed is we are moving the vertices by a little. So we call this kind of segments useless, because it doesn't help at all. So segment expansion, so the ones that are not useless we call it useful. And the segment expansion or useful segments always force progress. And once there's no useful segments, then the image graph is either trivial or is a site. So we can consider an analysis algorithm. So we define the potential to be two times the number of vertices in the polygon minus the number of vertices in the image graph. This number is linear to the number of vertices and is always non-negative. And then every expansion of a useful segment will always decrease its potential. So we know there's a most linear number of segment expansions. And naively we can do this in n squared time, but basically each segment expansion just brute force it. But with better data structures and heavy graph composition and more careful analysis, we can get it down to the module. So we assume the polygon does not have forks. So what happens if there are forks? So if the polygon has forks and spurs, what we do is just subdivide the edges. So and this will give us a quadratic blow up on the number of vertices. Therefore, this gives us the O(n) squared log n kind of algorithm. But if there's no spurs and there's only forks, then we can avoid the quadratic blow up using a more powerful expansion, so which we call the bar expansion. So we're expanding the entire a maximum line segment each time. So we can do it in log n time. So we have a natural open problem. Can we avoid the quadratic blow up and get an unknown time algorithm? The other one is, can we decide if the perturbation produces essentially unique simple polygons? Because when we have spurs, there can be many ways to perturb to create simple polygons that's really close to our original weakly simple polygon. So sometimes we need unique, and can we decide that? And finally, can we generalize this problem to graphs? Just if you consider a polygon as just a cycle, so maybe we can have more structure to it and check if an arbitrary graph is weakly simple, and I can perturb some of the vertices and make it simple. Thank you for listening.
Thanks to our polygons because of this.